I'm going to begin, I think, with a film clip. It should work. Hopefully it should work. We didn't check the sound, though. Very loud.
I'll tell you a story, if I may. Many years ago, when I first came to London, I was in the British Museum, naturally. And one of the West Indians who worked there started a conversation with me and wanted to know where I was from. And I told him I was from Harlem, and that answer didn't satisfy him. And I didn't understand what he meant. I was born in Harlem. I was born in Harlem Hospital, I said. I was born in New York. None of these answers satisfied him. He said, where was your mother born? And I said, she was born in Maryland. And I could see, though I didn't understand it, that he was going more and more disgusted with me. He was showing me more and more impatient. And where was your father born? My father was born in New Orleans. Yes, he said, the man, where were you born? And I began to get it. No, I said, well, I said, my mother was born in Maryland, my father was born in New Orleans, I was born in New York. He said, but before that, where were you born? I had to say, I don't know. I could see that he did not believe me. I tried to explain, you know, there's no way for me. He said, don't you care not to find out? And I tried to explain that if I were originally from Dakar, from wherever I was in Africa, I couldn't find out where it was because my entry into America is a bill of sale. And that stops, you know, that stops you from going any further. At some point in our history, I became Bob and Dinner. That's how I got my name. Now, you know, that really cannot be considered, you know, my fault. It can't be considered the fault of the cat in the British Museum either, that I don't, that he doesn't know that I can't find that out. And I tell you that story to dramatize the nature of the distance created deliberately. Because when I became Bowman's nigger, it's also very important to point out, I was handcuffed to another man from another tribe whose language I did not speak. We did not know each other. And we could not speak to each other because if we could have spoken to each other, we might have been able to figure out what was happening to us. And if we could have figured out what was happening to us, we might have been able to prevent it. We would have had, in short, a kind of solidarity, which is a kind of identity, which might have allowed us, which might have made the history of slavery very different. Of saving the North American continent, I mean. Well, it didn't happen. Here we are.
Okay, so I'm just going to talk. I'm going to kind of talk you through a project which was actually at Innova. this last year, but just kind of to give you a bit of context to my practice, because I'm not sure everybody know the kind of work that I do, but my work is basic. I kind of work in a, I suppose, in a social practice, mainly using the context of place, Britain mainly, though I have worked in other places. And I'm kind of interested in the social and political and cultural context of these places and how we kind of create ourselves within these places. So a lot of my work has been, kind of looking at like gypsy culture and looking at places and like Brixton and various different historical places, but also connecting to this idea of migration. So I'm also interested in the intergenerational and the intercultural. So I stumbled upon Baldwin's Nigger. Through watching other films of Horace's, actually. And I'm also a really massive fan of Jimmy Baldwin. And so watching this again and thinking about the conversation that's happening, it's happening at in the West Indian Student Centre, which is in London. I was kind of interested in how this dialogue translates into a contemporary context, especially contemporary Britain, and especially because, you know, a lot of the kind of thinking for sort of, I certainly know for myself when I'm thinking, I was thinking through ideas of race in the 90s was coming from the States. So, you know, how do we kind of read that? So I met my co-conspirator, Teresa Cisneros, who was a curator at Innovation. Well, she's kind of still is for a little while. And we talked about the idea of reloading this work, like thinking about it, thinking about having discussion, making a kind of a group of or having a discussion with a younger audience around the issues of this. And so in the summer we proposed this to a number of selecting art, young artists, and they're from a variety of different backgrounds. They worked with us to develop this project, which was called Baldwin's Nigger Reloaded, and they'd developed a collective which is called the Sorry You Feel Uncomfortable collective, and basically we took over Rivington Place on the 22nd of August 2014. So I'm just going to show you a little clip of the West Indian Social Centre. Should work. I might have to click on this one. No, it's not. That one's not working. That's a shame. Yeah, go to the next one. That's a real shame because that slide was of the Princess Margaret opening the West Indian Social Centre in 1955, where it's very colonial and they've got these lovely sort of images of people making Caribbean arts. So it's really kind of. It was really, really to just kind of get people thinking. So Baldwin's Nigger is a documentation of this talk that happened in 1968 at the West Indian Social Student Centre, which was in Earl's Court. And in 67, the Caribbean artist movement started to hold meetings there. And one of the parts of our research was going to the George Padmore Institute, and although they couldn't confirm it, I think that the Baldwin talk was actually programmed by the CAM guys. So that was one of their talks. What's striking to me about this conversation, thinking about Baldwin, is that, you know, in order to kind of see himself, he moved away from America. He kind of relocated himself in France. He had a bit of time in Turkey as well, but he had to have this sort of discussion about himself in a different place. So he kind of presents this idea in this talk about unpicking the Western world, and he's trying to figure out who he is and his relationship to America. As the clip goes on, he kind of describes this sort of distinction between him being a black man in America in the 1960s and also an American citizen, because this is how he's also seen when he is in Europe, which is quite interesting because, you know, maybe the European Africans and Arabs are not necessarily seen that way in France at that time. So describing this, he says... he says, and you know, as you grow older and you watch the richest city in the world, this is New York in the 1960s where he was living, you know that the most famous and richest, freest nation in the world, in the Western world, I know how you watch as you grow older, literally, I can't do it like Jimmy because Jimmy's got a way of speaking, but I'm quoting it. And now this is not a figure of speech. The corpses of your brothers and sisters pile up around you, and not for anything they have done. They were too young to have anything to do with this. And then in this case, they were helpless. But what one does realise when you try to stand up and look the world in the face, like you had a right to be here, when you do that without knowing this is a result of it, you are attacked. You have attacked the power structure of the Western world. He goes on to say, and if I discover that those songs the darkies sang and sing were not just innocent expressions of primitive people, but extremely subtle and difficult, dangerous, and by one's presence, simply by the attempt to walk here and there, you have begun to frighten the white world. So, I mean, it's a really frank conversation. It's a really kind of out there conversation. The room is mostly filled with Caribbean young people, but it's also filled with Asian. I'm really trying to figure out who was actually in the room, because that's one of my interest areas. But he also says this is not a racial problem. It is a problem of whether you are willing to look at your life and be responsible to change it. So this was a kind of process-led dialogue. So I'm not going to kind of go really, really deep. Three things that really kind of struck me in thinking about this question of who is the people, constructions, and the we in relation to this project. And these were, you know, where we are now was a kind of in the social, political, cultural context we find ourselves in, the context of making and presenting work of this nature. I mean, so I suppose it's slightly different to but people who actually really want to talk about these issues, they want to talk about political, social, you know, and racial constructs within their work. And then lastly, how this has been explored and exploited in the sector, so kind of reiterating some of the stuff that you, Andrea, have said. So I'm going to show another clip.
There's a record special. I've got to give a record answer. I don't know if this is so. I'll tell you what I would like and what I hope. I think that black people, you know, there's a black experience. Let's put it this way. And I'm deliberately trying to distinguish the black experience from the Christian, the white Christian European experience. It seems to me that the black personality then has a kind of vigor, a kind of vitality, and a kind of a sense of life, of something which does not come from here, but comes from much deeper regions. I think the African personality is not so compartmentalized. I think that Europeans, the European personality, in the main, and this implies a very severe judgment of Christianity, a very severe judgment is not an indictment. I think that they are terribly worried about the flesh, the senses. I think they live in checks and balances which are really very nearly pathological. And you see them in relief in America. But in America, I, precisely, am the flesh, which the Christians must mortify. Now, according to me, and what I hope for in the future, the flesh is all you have. If you mortify that, there's no hope for you. Everything you find out through your senses. Everything all that happens to you, everything marvelous that happens to you in this frame, this tenement, this moral envelope, which should be, instead of beating it with chains and hammering nails through it and hanging it on crosses, it should be the celebration, your life, your body. And if that concept comes back into the world, it will come back only through the black bird so long. And that will change not only the black personality, change the world. I've seen janitors, black janitors overall, prouder than any English king, with a much more real pride. And that is what I would like to see. Anyway, the change in the personality will come about in that direction, because as one begins to come out of the mines and strike off the chains, by some miracle, what was nearly murdered in Africa is still there. Human energy cannot be destroyed. And that's what's coming back.
Okay, I'm going to show you some work by, again, this is going to take a moment to load. And I'm going to show another work.
Hey, do, la, re, do, la, re, do, la, re, do, la.
So these were two works by two of the young kind of artists and thinkers. Actually, one's an anthropologist, who's studying anthropology, and the other one's a photographer, that they presented on at the event. I mean, the Palimpsest, I just showed you a clip, but the soundtrack has got a lot of, it's kind of a sampled soundtrack of David Starkey talking about the, okay, I'm going to have very long really, talking about the riots and kind of lots of other stuff. So I'm going to really skip through because there's actually quite a lot more. And I do have some newspapers here that people can kind of get off me and talk about. Couple of other things that's happened. So there's a cartoon from one of the artists at Rivington Place. So the project took place at Rivington Place, and it was really important for, I think, because in the night when I graduated, I was really inspired by Innova. Innova was a really important place for, you know, kind of developing my thinking. Beyond the interest of myself, thinking about the relationships with different cultures, different ideas, and relationship to place. And it kind of seemed like it was really important to take it over. This was a performance piece that was kind of is kind of documented, and is looking at how this sort of that reversal where Baldwin is talking about being asked where he's from and how this kind of constantly happens still. This is the foyer. I love the fact that Baldwin is kind of looking confused in Rivington Place, thinking, oh, there's quite a lot of black folks in here. It's a decolonizing education workshop that was done by one of the groups. This is Zarina. She ripped off canvases. She was trying to find her place within in the context of the gallery. I just wanted to kind of pull this up because I found this the other day in the library, and it just really struck me that Innova is having this massive cut. We were in there taking it over, but the amount of money that Innova got in the beginning is kind of this almost the same amount. In fact, it was more than what it is going to receive now. So it's really, really, really sad that Innova is kind of not going to be there having. And it says artists of colour, but it's also this kind of discussion, this broader discussion with things. I've got one more thing that I want to say. I'll put that one back. And this is to do with the idea of diversity, because it really is a numbers game. It really does feel like a numbers game. And it feels to me, I won't go into it, but I do look at a lot at the idea of that Sara Ahmed has in her book on being included, when she sort of really is talking about this idea of diversity work, because I think the other thing that Inova was supposed to kind of do was this diversity work, but now it's talking about diversifying the mainstream, and kind of that goes back to Basil Jett's speech. What does that mean, diversifying the mainstream? And what does that mean when we're still having lots of conversations where, well, what I'm experiencing with younger artists is they still want to have conversations about very serious threats. I mean, going back to the things that they're really, really want to still talk about, they still feel like these histories are reproducing in their current time, and they are wanting to have conversations about making this work. I think I'll leave it there. I did have a little clip from a rather provocative clip. In fact, I probably could play it. Just, can I play this? Because it's very provocative. It's very provocative. I'm just leaving it as a question.
Do you think that there is any place for the white liberal in Black Hole? And when you answer this question, would you be kind enough to give the reasons? Because I've attended a lot of meetings on this subject of Black Hole, at which in particular English people feel very hurt, because you get the line from, say, the Black Hole, "We don't want you."
I suppose we're a little...
That's what I'm going to leave you with, basically.